you. Good to be here with all these words. I need to explain this a little bit. So the subtitle of the book is The Legacy of Trauma and the Labyrinth of Memory. And the book is organized around my personal narrative, a bunch of interviews I did, and a lot of research, all orbiting the theme of intergenerational transmission of trauma. And this particular passage that I'm going to read is where the title of the book comes from, Survivor Cafe. It's a scene that explains that. And it takes place in Germany in April of 2015 when I went for the 70th anniversary of the liberation of Buchenwald concentration camp, where my father was a prisoner when he was a teenager. And I was there with my father and also with my nephew. So we ourselves were three generations of Storm. And it was the third generation Germans who had organized this event. I don't like doing air quotes, but imagine air quotes around that word event. So. On a cloudy afternoon, the survivors are scheduled to sit at round tables in the circular halls of the State Theater in Weimar. Camera crews are hovering, always hovering nearby, obtrusively leaning giant microphones covered in some kind of woolly apparel, serious earphones framing serious faces as they focus on the focal point, which is to say, the point of intersection between the survivor and the civilian, the resident of Weimar who is gathering up his or her courage and curiosity and willingness, maybe that more than anything else, a willingness to engage, to connect, to ask a question, to say, I wanted to meet you, to say, I can't look you in the eye when I say this, but I want to have to say this because of what my parents did or did not do. My cousin and my nephew and I are sitting with my father at a table that is rectangular and not officially designated as part of the Survivor Cafe. My father, of course, is a survivor, and we are in a place that looks a great deal like a cafe, but he hasn't been given an assignment for this particular event. I'm not sure why. He wasn't feeling well the day we arrived. Maybe that's why. On a welcoming part of the schedule, during our carriage ride around town, our scenic tour of town, my father went ash gray and nearly fainted. The driver of the carriage, whose hands were the largest I've ever seen, turned the horses around so that my father could return to the hotel. Thanks to the careful planning of the young German organizers, a physician had been made available for any such emergencies. Set up in one of the ground floor rooms, the doctor listened thoughtfully to my father's elaborate explanation of his various medical conditions. He measured my father's blood pressure, listened to his breath with a stethoscope and took his pulse. You are, of course, under some additional emotional stress here, the doctor said gently. Perhaps you need to take it a bit easy. My nephew Ezra described the way a similar near-fainting episode had occurred on their shared flight from Boston to Frankfurt the day before. I couldn't help thinking back to previous visits to Germany with my father, each trip punctuated by a health crisis of one kind or another, the body speaking its own language. Each time, too, and always to my relief and amazement, my father recovers. He rebounds. Today, with his cane in hand, he insists on rejoining the group activities. I'm fine, he insists, don't worry so much. So, although we are a bit lost in the shuffle, we find seats anyway, still perplexed by what is supposed to be happening at this Survivor Cafe. Navigating the polished hallways of the State Theater is confusing enough, given the crowds of visitors. Peeking inside the ornate theater, I see that all the velvet seats are empty. Today's schedule is taking place in side rooms and in this windowed cafe area, marble floored and brightly lit. Intermissions must happen here, I think. My father looks grateful for a place on the margins, slightly apart from what is a rather confusing array of activities. A quartet of musicians has just departed from the cafe, and I'm not sure what event we just missed. An impressive number of men and women, young and old and in between, seem to be moving purposefully into and out of view. Is there some written program we have failed to acquire? Who are these people? For now, anyway, we aren't participants, not officially. A woman seated across from us hears me say to my father, "I guess you weren't given your own table for this." And she says, in accented English, "I would like to talk with you. Maybe we can have our own cafe." She says this, I notice, without using the word survivor. My father, whose German vocabulary and grammar have returned with total fluency, asks her politely, "Warum sind Sie hier?" I wait to see which language she'll use for her answer as to why she is here. I would like to understand every word, even though I know that the dialogue is meant to be for them, between them. She says to my father in English, "I'm here out of respect for you." And then her eyes water up, and so do mine, and I think my father's do too. "You're German," she asks him, "and you were in the camp?" "Ich bin Jude," my father says, looking directly into her face. The woman appears to be about a decade younger than I am, in her 40s. She reminds me of the daughter of a close family friend from my childhood, with straight brown hair and kind eyes, no makeup, a pair of small gold earrings. There is a long, noisy silence. "He was 16 when the camp was liberated," I say to her. A few other people have now approached our table, bending tentatively toward the conversation. There aren't any cameras or microphones near us, which I consider a relief. The woman across from my father says that she has two children and that she's a psychotherapist. "I don't want to tell you about my grandfathers," she begins after another pause, her mouth quivering, tears ready. Her hands on the table clutch some tissues, her words spill. "But I do want to tell you. They were both in the SS. This was all before I was born, of course, so long ago, but I feel ashamed. I have several clients in my practice. This feeling of shame is something they also have." She glances nervously at my father and at me. "It's not your fault," I say. I can't keep myself from saying the words. My father nods. "I don't hold it against your generation," he says. Throughout my life, I've heard him state this so many times, except that he was always expressing the idea in America, at a distance. He was speaking about them, not directly to them. "But it's good for you to know what happened," he continues, still holding her gaze, "to know how it could have happened." A pair of older women stand close by, still wearing their overcoats. I feel them listening intently, along with a 20-something man in a sweatshirt who has appeared just within reach of my peripheral vision. They are not speaking. I imagine they are barely breathing. The woman opposite my father wipes at her eyes with a now tattered tissue. "You know," she says, so softly, I'm not sure my father can hear her, "in Germany, self-love is very difficult." Her words enter me in a physical way. I feel the accident of her being born to carry what she must carry, and the equally accidental fact of my own birthright. She is a therapist trying to help heal the wounds of history, and I am a writer trying to do the same. Self-love is difficult for everyone, I think, but maybe harder for some, maybe much harder.